Like, comment, share, and subscribe. Pause the video right now to check out my social media, my radio show, and thatdrummerguy.com. And most of all, enjoy the following presentation.
Ready to start when you are,
so. Alright, awesome. Well, of course, again, we are here to talk about everything going on in the world of With the Dead, including the brand new album, Love, from With the Dead, coming out the 22nd of September through Rise Above Records. So, how did the writing process for the new album begin?
Kind of strangely, but also, very spontaneously initially anyway, because I don't know if you know anything about the history of what's happened between the first album and this one. In terms of the first album, there was like just three of us made that record. Tim Bagshaw played both bass guitar and electric guitar, and so we didn't have a bass player on the first record, and we had a drummer, Mark Greening, who's no longer with the band, so we obviously had to find a lineup to go further and continue. So this record was the first, well, it's only our second album, but it's the first album we made with a full band, you know, with bass player Leos, me and drummer Alex Thomas, and me and Tim. So it was like a proper band when we made this record. But the actual process itself was very spontaneous, as I said, because basically in January 2016, we got together to rehearse, mainly to rehearse the live set, because we had some live shows that we committed to, and we obviously had to get a lineup together for those. So I booked four nights rehearsal to try out Leo and Alex in the band to see how it was going to work. And after the first night, it became very clear that it was going to work perfectly. Both Leo and Alex just fitted into the band really well. And within the space of a couple of hours, we had the set like totally nailed. I mean, the set being the first album, basically. And then we still had these other three nights of rehearsals booked, because I booked like four nights, you see. We didn't really need to use the nights to rehearse the set because we got it down already. So what I suggested was that we work on some new material, and we did just that, and came up with like five brand new songs within the space of three nights, and recorded them like 2 days later. So it was very quick, you know, those tracks ended up being the last four tracks that you hear on the album now, as it is. One of them ended up on a flexi disc on Decibel magazine. So that was the first part of the writing process. The album obviously wasn't complete. I mean, so we had the rest of the year to do festivals and do all the shows we had booked, and also think about how we wanted the LP to be finalised. You know, we had the luxury of having like 7 or 8 months to try and get into our heads what was missing from those tracks that we recorded to make the album sound more complete. So we just spent the rest of the year doing what we had to do, and came back to it at the end of last year. And Tim came up with a bunch of ideas, like for three songs, and we recorded all three songs in January 2017, which is exactly a year after we did the first session for this new album. And yeah, we had one night's rehearsal and recorded three songs the following day. So the writing has been very, you know, the physical side to the writing and the physical side to the recording has been very fast. But a lot of time has been spent thinking about it, mulling things over, you know, obviously lyrically and stuff. In my mind, I think about things all the time, how to present the lyrics, how to approach them, the way I do the vocals, all these kind of things I'm thinking about all the time. But the actual act of physically recording and physically writing has been very fast.
Yeah, that's amazing to see. I mean, I just received the album yesterday, so I've only been able to spin it a few times, but it definitely sounds like something that was all recorded in one writing session. I mean, taking the time to be able to do that, but the fact that it was spanned over the course of a year, being able to get those first four tracks, which end up being the last four tracks, and then the last three tracks, which end up being the first three tracks. I mean, it's great to see how that all turned out to be.
Yeah, I mean, you know, for the first session, which is the last four tracks, Tim had basically a load of riffs knocking around. So he had like rough ideas, but we didn't have like songs, like finalized ideas for songs, because we really thought that, you know, those first set of rehearsals would be all we would be doing, would be rehearsing the live set. We didn't think we'd be working on new material so fast until like much later in the year, really. So these were just ideas that Tim had knocking around, a few riffs here and there, but we worked on them and turned them into songs. And I think that's the way that, that's the beauty of the way this band has worked so far, because it's very much a band that bases everything it does on a primal gut instinct, really. There's no kind of overanalyzation of what we do. We don't spend too much time trying to fine-tune things or trying to be clever with things. You know, if things feel right and they sound right, we just go with it. You know, we don't spend too much time fucking around, which is quite liberating to be able to do that after being in bands for years, when maybe sometimes you over-rehearse things and sometimes you overanalyze things, and sometimes you spent way too much time on recording things, and you kind of, you know, you can potentially lose the whole dynamic and vibe of a song by overdoing it. With this band, we'd, so far anyway, you know, that hasn't been the case. We've literally just gone on our instincts and followed them straight through, you know?
And I think that's a great approach to it, and that's what I really appreciate about the new album. I mean, everything from the production standpoint, the tones that are going on with the new album, I mean, it's so much sonically heavier than the debut, the writing style that's going on there. I mean, it just like, it feels like everything is just a natural progression from the first album, but it's great to hear that it was such a laxed writing session where you're just writing the music that you want to write.
Yeah. I mean, what? We just want it to be bare bones and all, really, you know? I mean, what can you say? It's harder to be, when you're in a band like this, you've got very talented musicians, you know, like Leo Smears is like a very talented bass player, and Alex Thomas is an extremely talented drummer. I mean, he could play like fucking any kind of jazz you can imagine. He's a session drummer, really. He's in like loads of other bands that he tours around the world with as a job, because that's what he gets paid to do. That is actually his living as a professional drummer. I mean, he's in with the Dead as a band member, but he's in loads of other bands as a paid hired drummer, you know. So when you've got like people that can play like that, and they're very capable of playing almost kind of any kind of style, to keep it minimalistic and keep it sonically heavy without straying too far into the realms of technicality or over complicating things or over music, you know, over making things too musical, that's kind of the hardest thing to do, really, because, you know, Leo would naturally come out with a melodic bass line over a real simple riff, but you have to keep that in check, you have to keep that kind of stripped down, so the nihilism of the intent of the song comes across more so than the musicality of it, if that makes sense. You know?
Oh, very much so. I've always known that the less is more approach that really does come into this style of music, and when you are able to slow that down with the tempo and the tuning and how many notes that you hit per riff, I mean, when you are able to minimalize that and really have that nihilistic feel to it, I mean, if you add too much to it, it could absolutely mess with the feel of it. So when you are able to scale back to it, it just leaves it the way it should be.
Well, you can also take too much away from it as well if you're not careful, you know. I mean, there's a lot of bands that just play an open chord for like 5 minutes and then there's the next beat follows after that. I mean, there's levels of extremity you can go to that can get kind of silly, I think. But I think the main thing is that, I mean, having been involved in this kind of music for so many years, it's just instinctively in your blood. You kind of know how you want it to sound before you've even played it. You know how it should sound, if that makes sense too. I mean, personally speaking, I don't listen to music that's this heavy anymore. I mean, I don't listen to the latest doom band playing this kind of heavy stuff, because I mean, most of the music I listen to is 50 years old, if I'm going to be honest. But playing in a band like this and doing this kind of music is like I say, it's in our blood. It's what we, if you're going to do a doom band, we want to do it like this, you know.
And it's exactly what I'm looking for when it comes to being in a doom band. Like I mentioned before, just sonically, the production is so perfect on this album, and just the right amount of riffs that are going on in the songwriting. I mean, whether it's a 17 and a half minute epic or one of the shorter songs in comparison to that, I mean, it just feels like every song is the way that it should be on this album.
Oh, cool. Well, I mean, the 17 minute track you're talking about, CV1, I mean, when the idea for that was first conceived, I did personally think like the second half of that song was a bit kind of, it didn't really go anywhere. It was almost like a drone, really. The first half was like full of was based around riffs, and then the second half kind of drifts off into drone land, but it was, I was just looking for a way to make that feel more complete. And I don't know if you know, but a friend of mine, the friend of the band, guested on the latter part of that track, and give it some kind of sense of focus and some kind of sense of purpose. I mean, a friend of mine called Russell Haswell. Well, basically, I mean, we could go on for loads of reasons why he's on that track. First and foremost, he's an old friend of mine, and secondly, the song is about Coventry, so it made sense for him, coming from a completely kind of different musical area than we do, although very much the same in many respects because we're very close friends and stuff. It just, having someone playing power electronics over the end part of that song, and the song being about Coventry and him being about being from Coventry, just seemed to make perfect sense, and it kind of opens up the album to, I don't know, just gives it a completely different dimension, I think. And I think it's a good way to end the record, because I think everything leads to that, hopefully, you know. And I think it, hopefully it opens us up next time for maybe different options or different areas we can explore, you know.
Yeah, I was just about to say the same thing. I mean, it's such a great turn for the end of the album to be able to show off more of that direction in there. And yeah, when it does come to be time for the third album, I mean, it does leave door open for so many different styles that can be incorporated with it, but yeah, making sure that it fits the mold of what With the Dead does.
Exactly. I mean, where we go after this one is it's a very much an open book. I really don't know. I mean, making this album heavier than the first one was no easy feat. I mean, yeah, you know, the music's down tuned and it's raw, but that's not what makes the record heavy. I think it's what you put into it emotionally is what makes the record heavy, personally speaking, anyway. And some of the personal experiences I've been through the last few years have not been that fucking great, to be honest. And the same goes for Tim as well. And when you're in a band that plays this kind of music, I mean, surely the one place where you're going to channel all these negative things that you've gone through or make them positive is to channel them through your music. I mean, that's why the album's called Love From With The Dead as well. I mean, it seems like on the surface that it's a sarcastic kind of title, but it's not really. If you think about, well, you're not going to really know what I've gone through personally, whether it's health or personal problems or whatever, but if you think about us ourselves putting ourselves in on the line and opening up in such a way that we do on this record to people that are going to buy the record or listen to the record, that's us giving our love to those people that are going to be listening to it. You know, it's not a mundane thing to say that. I think it's a very true thing though, because although a lot of the themes and content on the album are about the death of love, it's still about love in itself as a very much an important thing and part of life, because without love you're fucked, aren't you, really? There's nothing in the world without love except emptiness, negativity and despair, you know. So, and that's a lot of what the album is trying to convey, those kind of negative feelings. Not trying to convey them, they're expressing those feelings because they're the feelings we've gone through. And that, to me, is what makes a record heavy. It's personal experience, as opposed to singing about dragons and I don't know, whatever else you might sing about, you know, fantasy. Which has, you know, obviously through my own time of being in bands, those kind of fantasy things, which might seem like fantastical on the surface, they've always had like deeper, darkest, even sinister undercurrents to them, you know. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about this album. So those personal experiences have definitely come through this point. And I think, you know, to go through heavy experiences and put those heavy experiences into the music makes the music heavier, I think, you know.
Yeah, and I was going to bring that up as well, and I'm glad you did, about from the lyrical and thematical aspects of the album. That's the heaviest aspect of it all, I mean, let alone the production and the songwriting. I mean, when you really divulge into the themes and the lyrics of what's going on there, I mean, for so many people, it can be so relatable, going through struggles in life, and like you mentioned, the death of love, and love in itself. I mean, in a way, it's a very positive thing to be able to talk about these experiences.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that, actually, because, you know, on the surface, again, you could look at this record and it's like, oh, they're just moaning and being miserable, and it's like, why would you want to listen to that depressing shit, you know what I mean? But actually, you know, I think a lot of people can probably relate to what we are expressing in this record, because we're not the only people that go through these things, you know. When you've got people who suffer from depression and anxiety, I mean, I don't personally, because I can deal with things. I'm fortunate enough to be in a band like this where I can get these things out of my system, really, but in a cathartic way of thinking. I mean, I used to listen to records that were so-called depressing, and they would make me feel better because I could hear the pain that someone was going through and what they're expressing in their music. It made me feel like somebody I can relate to the feelings they're going through, because I'm feeling them myself, you know. And when you've got that backed by an overwhelming weight of heaviness in the riffs and the music and the power behind it musically, then I think it can, you know, it can be soul-crushing, but also elevating at the same time, you know, I think.
Yeah, very much so. I mean, there's so many different styles of music that just love to incorporate the happiness of life and just going to parties all the time, the sex, drugs, and rock and roll, all of that stuff. But when you are able to really divulge into the darker aspects of life, it's a lot of stuff that people don't like to talk about in normal culture. But when you are having those feelings and you are able to find some kind of art, like with the Dead, being able to hear about these themes, hear about these the lyrical content, the events that are going on with it, and you are able to transcribe it into your own personal life, you are able to realize that other people are going through struggles too, and you are able to relate to it, and it can make you feel better with that, knowing that you're not alone.
Well, I hope so, because we're not trying to promote like depression, you know what I mean? We're trying to promote positive things through the darker side of life, I suppose, you know?
And with that, when you were able to finish up your part of the recording for the album, did you feel like a purge at all, being able to get all these experiences out there from your lyrical content?
I felt like when the album was mastered and that was it, I had no more to do. I'd sorted out all the artwork and all the lyrics were done. The LP was mixed and mastered. I felt like something in my life instantly changed. I actually went and got a haircut. I had my fucking haircut the same day because I just felt relieved and I wanted to get out of the way I was, you know, the mindset I was in. I know it's like a silly little trivial thing to say you went and got your haircut, but it was part of the skin I'd been living in whilst that writing process was going on. It was kind of not a place I really wanted to be for much longer. And when the record was actually, it was almost like this is what I was living and breathing, was this record. And when it was done, I did feel like I could finally switch the button off now and I could live again outside of it, you know. That might sound a bit dramatic, but it's actually true.
Oh yeah, I mean, when people actually do get to experience this album and they are able to follow along with the lyrics, I mean, they'll see like how dark and heavy this album really is. And anyone who does live with that burden of feeling that way for so long, I mean, that's got to take a toll on you. So when you are able to purge that out of your system and you are able to get that out of your mind, I mean, that's got to be a great feeling to be able to get more positive.
It is. And also, you know, wanting to be satisfied with the record itself, not just getting all the things out of your system. You know, you actually want the record to be as you want it to be, you know. I mean, I spent 2 weeks in hospital while this was going on in a dementia bloody ward. Well, it wasn't a dementia ward, but it was a ward full of dementia patients. And that just made me think, it made me think all kinds of things, you know, just about existence. But I was already kind of thinking anyway, but when you're in that situation where you're almost institutionalized, you can't get out because you have to stay in hospital until you're better. When you're forced to be in a situation like that, you realize how important, just your sanity is for a start, and how much, let alone your physical well-being. But you can see that, you know, certain people have given up on life. And I mean, it's very easy to, I think, lose the will to want to live. And when there's so much that life has to offer, if you just were somehow able to stick around and get over your thoughts that are dragging you down so much to the point where you actually feel about you don't want to live anymore, you know, I think being surrounded by people that were almost dying for a couple of weeks, and they didn't really have, I mean, a lot of these people didn't have anyone close to them. They were getting, where they weren't getting any visitors. I mean, I had conversations with some of the guys and they were very set in their ways and stuff, and it just made me feel extremely sad, you know. And also very thankful for the life that I've got. When you're in that kind of environment, it just makes you feel, when you get out of that environment, you're like, wow, you know, I'm actually very pleased to be alive. I mean, there's so much negative shit going on in this world at the moment, it becomes very disillusioning. And I can see why people do get down, and I can see kind of a lot of different angles as to why people would be, I don't know, I mean, in America, you know, at the moment it seems like there's, I mean, everywhere is kind of divided. I think every country in the world is like divided at the moment, but America it seems to be extremely so, you know. Unfortunately, there's a lot of shit we're going to have to go through before things get better, you know, in terms of a global sense, and it's kind of daunting. But also, I think there's a lot of people who are actually prepared to stand up and resist the shit that's been thrown at them. So it's very, you know, it's very uncertain times at the minute, and we don't know what's going to happen within the next 4 or 5 years, how things are going to change socially, you know. I don't know what led me to saying all this from the initial point we were making with this question, but it's going off on a tangent, I suppose.
Oh, that's quite all right. I mean, I would rather have something like that than Reading off a piece of paper and just asking questions, not really paying attention to what you're listening to, but really being able to get into that mindset, because it just makes everything that much more personal and real as well. I mean, knowing the aspects of what you were going through and seeing those people with dementia going through all of these life struggles, and then when you go around the world and see everything, I mean, I can only, living here in America, I can only imagine what the representation of America is throughout the rest of the world, and I'm sure it's not a good outlook on everything. And like you mentioned, like, every country's got some division that's going on, and there is gonna be a lot more struggle going on before things get better. But you know, it's just the important thing is just trying to be able to move on and trying to progress, try to get more positivity out there. I mean, even if it's through a negative context, you know, just like love from with dead, you know, just like just trying to find some way to keep going.
I just think people, I don't know, all this like Facebook, social media lifestyle, where it's just complete obsession with Facebook. I mean, it's just so shit. It's horrible, you know. People have just become so lazy and apathetic. They're watching the world fall apart around them, and all they can do is just rant about it on Facebook. Well, why don't you just fucking like find something within yourself to make yourself a better person and make the world a better place? Stop being so fucking lazy, you know what I mean? Just sitting on your ass and moaning about the world on Facebook, and that's all you do, you know. And all you do is like read what other people say about the state of the world. Get out there and do something about it, you know what I mean? Or just do something about your own kind of state of mind. Make yourself a stronger person. I don't know, but if people don't change their mentality and their outlook, things are going to get a lot fucking worse in every aspect.
Yeah, because the people that are going to be out and trying to do something, if you're opposed to it, they're the ones that are actually going to be doing something. If you're just sitting behind a computer screen and complaining about everything that's going on around you, I mean, exactly, you got to take initiative and try to make things better for your own personal life, and if you are able to make it more in a global sense.
Well, I find it all false as well, these people just kicking off on social media. It's almost like they're not really concerned about the world. They just want some credibility for themselves, that they've got an opinion that people will either hate or despise or give them a round of applause for. That seems to be more what it's like than actually like genuinely wanting to, or genuinely having an opinion. It just seems like a load of hot air to me, you know, unfortunately.
Yeah, and there's definitely a lot of things in America I could definitely apply that to. I mean, governments or otherwise, I can definitely see that, how that is the approach, and that is the sad state of the world today. Rather than people living, they would rather just try to appease everybody that they see on a screen.
Yeah, it's a shame. It's really sad.
I was just going to say, I know we only have a couple minutes left here, so I was hoping to end things on a little more of a positive note here with the album coming out at the end of the month. What's next for the band?
The beauty of this band is we never really planned that much or planned that far ahead, so there isn't anything planned at the moment. I mean, hopefully I think we're going to be coming over to the States in April, May time, but that's not confirmed yet. And then, you know, we'll be doing festivals around Europe, I suppose, next year, but nothing is confirmed at the moment. The album's just going to come out, and then we're just going to play it by ear to see what happens next with it.
And I'm glad to see that kind of lax feel behind it. I mean, not just in the songwriting, but, you know, just getting together when you can, playing the shows when opportunities that feel right are able to work out, and just being able to promote the album on your own terms. That's a great way to do it.
We're very fortunate to be in that situation, yeah, because we can just do it on our own terms. Like I say, you know, we don't have a manager. The record company is ours, basically. We don't have any pressure or demands to do this, that, and the other. We can just take our time and do it as we please. And that's, after being in bands for years, when you sign to like a bigger record label and you have a manager, and I don't know, it's, that can become very disillusioning. So we're in no urgent, we have no urgent desire to be like getting stressed about fulfilling demands or being in people's faces and over promoting ourselves. We just let things happen naturally. It's a nice position to be in, to be able to do that, really.
Oh, very much so. Because if you tour too much, if you do too much promotion, if you put too much time and effort into it and everything, it can just completely burn you out.
Yeah. I mean, we've done all that before, you know. We've been in bands that have toured the world 10 times over in the space of the years between us. We've all been in bands, you know. So it's not like it's anything new to us. So, and plus, we're not kids anymore either, you know. I mean, I'm 50 next year. Fuck's sake. I mean, I never thought I'd get to be this age, let alone be still in a band while I am at this age. And it doesn't feel weird to me. It doesn't feel like I'm an old man playing this kind of music. It just seems like it still feels all right. I don't know. It's weird. I mean, when I was like 18, the thought of being the age I am now just seemed like a million miles away, you know. But it doesn't seem that different to as I was doing it then. Obviously, it is different in many respects, but the actual purpose seems to be almost the same. But, yeah, it's quite a weird feeling.
And,
but a good one, too.
Oh, yeah. I was just going to say, what a great send-off to the first half century of your life, then being able to have such a great, heavy album, then with Love from the Dead, the second album from With the Dead, coming out the 22nd of September through Rise Above Records. And I really appreciate you taking all this time to be able to talk to me about everything that's going on in your world right now, and the state of the world as well. Just being able to get like a good, real conversation about everything, and I really appreciate you taking the time to do this.
Oh, thank you, Josh. Well, thank you for taking the time to talk to me. Yeah, it works both ways, so thank you.